So last couple times we looked at the value of include files in making our code more maintainable. It gives us another way of putting our code in one place so that we can share it among different pages. The difference here is that it's actual HTML, PHP, or really anything that you can put in a PHP page, we can share. So we saw in the example that I used include files to put blocks of HTML code that sort of were the building blocks for my basic page. In other words, the header, the footer, the navigation section, and all that. And that has a big advantage of if I want to change one piece of it, one of the include files, I can make the change, and I can change it throughout the system. And that's a great benefit. I mean, it gives us for HTML the capability that we had with CSS and JavaScript, the ability to put our code in one place and make the modifications only in one place and get the change throughout the system. But beyond the HTML, we can put PHP functionality in there as well. And in the heart rate example, we saw that we were able to put code in an include file, and now that we're able to do that, we can build on that, all right? And we can do our second page. If you remember, I wanted to have two pages. The first page was sort of a chart that showed, depending on your age, what your range was for exercising, what you should shoot for your heart range to be. I wanted another page in there too, where a lot of the places recommend that you take your heart rate for 6 seconds, multiply it by 10, and then look to see if you're in the range. So the page that I want to do is going to look something like this. I'm going to have, starting out, the text box. You might change this later on just to vary things up. But beats per 6 seconds, age, and calculate, then this should return a page that either says, congrats, you know, you're in the range, or warning, not in range. All right, so we could do one of those two messages. And again, depending on how much effort we want to put into this, we could style these two things differently to give a more ominous looking warning message if they are outside of the range. We could put an image if we wanted to, a happy face if they're in the range, a frowny face if they're outside the range. We can do whatever we want to because we're going to have code that generates the HTML, and therefore we can generate the HTML dynamically based on our calculations. Now, right now we don't have anything that does this, that takes the rate for 6 seconds and the age and calculates it. But we do have pieces of it. Let's look to see what pieces we have, and then we'll try to figure out what pieces we need to add. Because the whole idea is we might have to write a little bit of it, but we're going to look to see what we already have. All right? We're going to look to see what we already have do this. Now, again, the key of being able to reuse functions is writing good functions. What do I mean by writing good functions? Well, the function should not refer to anything that's on the page. So I shouldn't have, like, pulling something from a query string, because that depends on the page that you're on, all right? Everything the function needs should be passed to it in the form of an argument. And the function should return one thing, and that is the return value. engineering a black box. A black box is where you know what goes in and you know what comes out, but you don't really care what happens in the middle. All right? That's details. The person that designed it needs to know what goes on in the middle, but anyone that uses the functions doesn't really need to do that. So let's look at what we have, and let's look at the functions that we have, and see if they're good functions, see if they're going to serve our purpose here, and see what we need to add. A lot about software development is looking to see what you can leverage that has already been written, or that exists in a framework, or something along that lines. All right. So yes, you're going to have to write your own code, but that's not always the first answer. You know, many of you will probably take CISS 243, which is web database integration, or maybe some of you have already taken that. That is also a server-side scripting language, and the ASP.NET framework provides a lot of objects that do a lot of work for you. All right. Now, that doesn't mean that you're not going to write any code or that you're not going to need to configure those objects or whatever, but the point is you're not going to want to duplicate functionality that's already given to you for free. All right. So in this case, we've written our own function, so we're going to see if we can use those or not. Because if we can, that's great. If not, we might look to see what we can do so that we can use the same code in two places. Reusing code is so much of a goal, all right? And it's good for so many reasons. You know, it makes maintenance easy. It makes debugging easy. It makes correcting errors easy, because if there happens to be an error in the code, there's only one place to change it. So let's see what we have, and let's see if it's good. And by good, I mean reusable. This is called error version, but actually it is working. I'm going to move this over to my web server, which is, for me, it is the folder CINETPUB www.root. For good measure, I'm going to clear out what's already there. Copy this stuff over here. And I should be able to go to localhost. And again, I'm not going to specify a page. And the way the web server is configured, index.php is one of the pages that it will look for. So if I don't supply a web page, it has a list of pages that it's going to look for, and for the default, and that will be the one that it'll pull up. So here we are. I go to the chart. Shows me the range. All right. Let's go back and sort of take inventory of what we have in here. Chart code looks like this. Where I have a loop, and I call the function calculate minimum exercise rate, calculate maximum exercise rate, and then I output that to the cell, and then I output the age. All right? So these functions look reusable because they take an argument and they return the value. Let's look closer at the function just to make sure that we're correct about that. on the page or anything in the query string or anything like that. Everything it needs, it guesses an argument, and then it returns the result. So calculate max rate, calculate minimum exercise rate, calculate maximum exercise rate. So these are all good functions. They do only one thing. Now, I could have written a function that outputted a string that said the range, just a string that says, you know, 140 to 180 beats per minute. The problem is I would not be able to reuse that. It's good when functions do one clearly defined thing and just one clearly defined thing. All right? So calculate rate, calculate minimum rate, calculate maximum rate, and whoever calls this function decides how to format the output. Right? I might want to use the output from this function any number of different ways. All right? So therefore, it's not going to format the output. It's not going to do any formatting of the output. It's simply going to return the values, and whoever called it will go and do that. Formatting the output is something that's going to vary depending on what page you're using the function on. So that's a real sort of small issue in most cases. The actual calculation is going to be more involved. So I'm in pretty good shape. Now, what am I going to need to add to this? I'm going to need to add to this a test that says check to see if it's in range. All right? And I could do this a couple different ways. I could have it return a Boolean. That is, I could have it return a true or false to say, yes, it's in the range, no, it's not in the range. But I'm going to have it, but really, if you think about it, there's three conditions that are important here. You could be below the desired range, you could be within the range, or you could be above the range. I don't think it's enough to say that you're not in the range, because that doesn't really tell the person enough. You know, if you were to imagine this to be on a mobile web page app that you could do while you're exercising and you put in your rate and it says you're not in the range, you might say, oh, I need to work harder, when really you're working too hard. Or the other way around. Maybe you're not working hard enough and you see it. No, the other way around. Maybe you're already working too hard. Oh, I don't know. The opposite situation would be bad too. All right. If you weren't working hard enough and it said you were outside the range and you're like, oh, I'm working too hard, and then take it even easier. You know, sit down and put your feet up because you're working too hard or something like that. So I'm going to write a function, and I'm going to try to make it a good function, and I'm going to try to use the pieces I already have. I'm not going to do any of these recalculations. So how would I know if I was in the range or not? Well, I would first calculate the maximum value and the minimum value, all right? I would then take the number of beats per 6 seconds and multiply by 10, all right? And then I would then compare to see if the current heart rate is between the minimum and maximum. So I can reuse these functions because I'm calculating the maximum, I'm calculating the minimum. All I need to do is do the little bit of calculation of multiplying the rate times 10 to get it for a full minute. Call the minimum, call the maximum function, get the minimum and maximum, and then actually do the test to see if it's in the range. So I'm going to create my function here. I could do this in any order. I'm writing the PHP function first, but I could create the form first. But I'm already in this file, so I might as well do it. I'm going to make this just a little bit more flexible by putting in how many seconds I took the rate for. That way, I could have another page that you enter in your heart rate for a minute, and it would tell you, and it wouldn't do the math. So I'm going to enter in the range many beats there were. And how many seconds. You put it for. Now, one thing that I don't do a very good job of, and this is a case of, you know, do as I say, not as I do, is I don't do a good case of commenting the code. One thing I would suggest would be a good exercise is for you to go and comment the code that I've created. It's a good way to sort of study what I've done. But I'm going to put some comments in here because with this function, one thing that you can use a comment of, especially if it's not obvious, is comment what the arguments mean. All right? So I'm going to say this function accepts these arguments. I'm going to explain what they mean. The age of person, that one's obvious. How many pulse beats were counted? How many seconds took pulse for? So, it's not required, but I like to start my arguments with arg, just so that I know that they're an argument being passed in. All right, so I can say beats per minute equals arg beats times 60 divided by arg seconds. Make sure we understand what that does. If I counted that there were 10 beats and I took the pulse for 6 seconds, it would be 10 times 60 divided by arg seconds. So if that was 6 seconds, that would be 10. 10 times 10. So if my pulse was 10 beats for 6 seconds, then that's 100 beats per minute. And I'm going to say max equals and at this point I'm going to step back and glow with pride for a second because I've just reused that function. I took something that I already had and I am reusing it in this calculation. And that's a good thing. That's one of our big goals. So, I now have that. I can test. So I can say if BPM is less than min, I'm going to return a negative 1. And that would also be good to comment. All right, what my return values are. So I'm giving comments so that anyone that uses this function can look at it and know how to use it. Ideally, a person should be able to use a function if all they know is what the arguments mean and what the return result does. They shouldn't need to know anything about the calculations. All right? So, if beats per minute is less than minimum, then that else. And I could write this a bunch of different ways. I'm going to not use nested if statements. Now use a compound condition. I'm going to say if beats per minute is greater than or equal to minimum, and beats per minute is less than or equal to max, then I'm going to return 0. And then I'm going to return the answer. So that looks correct to me, and we can test that out to make sure that it's correct. It's not correct. It should be a 1. All right, so let's save this. Now I'm going to go and I'm going to create the form. Now if you remember, I called it calculator.php, so I'm going to create a new page. And just to save some time, I'm going to copy this. This will be the HTML, not the PHP. So I'm going to put my form in here. Action equals, the action, remember, is the name of the server-side script that I'm going to call. We'll call it check range. The method is either post or get. Do get because we want to see it on the query string. Just in the interest of time, I'm going to make a real bare bones form. All right. Now, just for good measure, I'm going to copy everything over and test it to make sure that this is working. So I'm going to take my calculator and this guy, copy it over. There we go. And of course I get an error. But I can see that it is calling check range and it's passing the age and the number of beats on the query string. It didn't pass the submit button. That's okay, but I'm going to put in a name because it doesn't pass anything that doesn't have a name. So now I have to go and write check range. Again, I could take this as far as I wanted to in terms of what PHP I'm going to output, but we'll start out at least doing this very simple. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to grab those values from the query string. So, what are the values on the query string called? They're going to be called whatever the name is. So, txt age and txt beats. So, I'm going to go age equals $ underscore request. Notice how these are square brackets. Alright? Where have we seen square brackets before in programming? We've seen them before, probably anyhow. Maybe I shouldn't assume. We've seen them before with arrays. So really, that's really what the request object is. It's an array. Alright? Or maybe I should say in addition to being indexed by numbers, being indexed by name. So in other words, I can specify the name of the thing that I want on the query string, and it will give me that. So, result equals, and I can call my function. I better make sure I include that include file. And as we remember from last time, we have to include it before it's going to be called, because this is a one-pass interpreter. Doesn't go back and look for stuff if it wasn't there. So result equals, what's my function name? It is in range. And I have to give it those three things. Since this page specifically says
said enter your heart rate for 6 seconds, I can hard code that value to 6. All right. Later on, I might make a version of this page where you choose what you've done. Have you done it for 30 seconds? Have you done it for 10 seconds? Have you done it for 6 seconds? Whatever. But I gave that as an argument. So since this page is specifically done for 6 seconds, I'm going to just pass it the value of 6. Now I'm going to do a test and say if result equals -1, now I could do this, I could either do this with a print or I could pop out a PHP and have whatever HTML that I want to. I'm going to pop out of HTML, pop back into HTML rather, pop out of PHP. And I'm going to write HTML that will say you are below exercise optimal exercise heart rate. Result equals 0, you are in again, this could be as extensive if I wanted to. I could put different images in here. If I wanted to put an image to indicate someone laying on the couch with their feet up, like you're not working hard enough, this could be someone that looks exhausted. This could be someone who looks like they're enjoying their workout. All right. Let me clean up this code a little bit. I think I reversed these. It's very important to line things up properly because PHP can really get to be very messy code. And if you don't have things lined up properly, it's going to be very difficult for you to tell where a block of PHP ends and a block of HTML begins. I think this is right, so I'm going to go move it over and test it. Let me save everything. So if my age is 50, my beats per 10 seconds, or 6 seconds is 10, you're in optimal heart range. Is that correct? So I said I was 50. Let's check this a couple different ways. Let's check this based on our chart. So if I was 50 and my heart rate was 10 beats per 6 seconds or 100 beats per minute, yeah, that's in the range. Let me manually go and check that too. So 220 minus 220 minus 50 is 170. 50% of 170 would be 85. And 80% is it? Or yeah. 80% of 170 would be, that's a good question. I'm going to assume it is 136. So it does fit in a range. Now, testing this. Testing software is very important. Do we raise our hands in victory and high-five our friend and say that we're done? No. I've only tested one thing. I've put in a value that was in the range, and it told me it was in the range. So that's good. All right? It's a good start, but that's not really testing it sufficiently. What I should do is I should test something below the range. So let's say my age is 50 and my beats per 6 seconds are 4. So that would be, my pulse would be 40 beats per second, per minute. I'm below optimal range. All right, that's correct. Let's put in a real high number. 40 beats per 10 seconds. My heart's working overtime, more than overtime. So that would be 400, and clearly that would be over the range. And it tells me I'm above. Have I done tested it yet as well? Even though I did the three, I did all possible ranges. No. Really, one thing that we should do is we should test the borders of these things. What do I mean by borders? I mean, if we look at the chart, for a 50-year-old person, or let's do a 20-year-old person because that's a little easier. For a 20-year-old person, 100 should say that they're in the range. 99 should say that they're not in the range. So I should test right in that range. I should test slightly above, or rather right on that range to make sure it gets it right. So it doesn't tell them that 100 is 100 is not in the range. Because there's always the issue when you write code. You know, is it greater than or equal to? Is it less than or equal to, or whatever? So I want to test that border. All right? So I'm going to go in, I'm going to say for calculator, I'm going to have a 20-year-old person, and I know that 10 beats per second is going to be exactly 100. So that should tell me for this person that I'm in the range. And it does. So I'm good. I'm going to put in slightly below 10. So I'm going to put 9.99. And it tells me I'm below the optimal range. So that's refining the test a little bit better. So in other words, that border works exactly correct, all right? And we would want to do that on the maximum end of things as well. So for a 20-year-old person, 160. So for 6 seconds, that would be 16, would be right on the border. 16.1 should be above. So let's test that. 20-year-old. 16, I'm in the optimal heart range, that's good. If I do 16.1, I don't know how you're counting 0.1 of a heartbeat, but we can test that. It tells me I'm above. All right. Notice I also tested multiple ages. I just didn't do all my testing for 50-year-old people. All right. I did some for 50 and some for 20. The point is even something simple as this. really requires a lot more testing than you might originally consider. All right? There's three ranges in this page. There's above, below, and right in the middle. So you at least want to test those, but that probably isn't enough. You want to test the borders to make sure that the borders work the way that they're supposed to. And in addition, because age is a factor, you want to test with different ages to make sure that is. So if I was going to write a test plan for this, and what's a test plan? A test plan is a list of the things that I'm going to test. All right. I can go in and I would write a test plan to say, test a 20-year-old person at 10 beats per 6 seconds. Test a 20-year-old person at 11 beats. Test a 20-year-old person at 16 beats. Test a 20-year-old person at 16.1 beats. All right. So I might have, and then I might do the same thing for another age. So I might have 8 different test conditions, or 10, or however many that would end up being, for just this one simple page. Testing is important, right? Because it's not likely, unless you really have made a half-hearted effort, it's not likely that your code is always going to break or always give a bad answer. That's not how bugs in software work, all right? Bugs in software work when you have some very specific condition that just doesn't work right, all right? I had a student in my Java class that on the midterm they had to do a sales rep commission, and the border for the commission was if they sold 50,000, less than 50,000, they got one thing, one rate. If they sold 50,000 or more, they got another commission rate. Well, their test code or their code had less than 50,000, greater than 50,000. So if a sales rep sold exactly 50,000, then they would have got zero commission for that month, and you would have one unhappy sales rep. All right. So testing is really something that I think most people don't do, or many programmers don't do a good job at it, because they don't think about it systematically, and they don't think about, like, where are the different conditions that I need to test, where are the borders between conditions that I need to test, and so on. All right. Any questions about what I have so far? Now, of course, I could have made this more elaborate. I could have used different styles to make it look different if they were above or below. Different colors, different font sizes. I could put different images out there. But the basic idea of this works. And we did a good job because we have code now that can be reused. All right? We have code that that can be reused, and in fact, we reuse the code from the previous example. All right, so our includes allowed us to reuse the HTML, and our includes for the PHP calculations, we were allowed to take those and build upon them. So we didn't have to reinvent the wheel. Now, here's the good news. Let's say that there was a different way to calculate the heart rate. Let me Google to see if there is. I knew there had to be another way to do it. Let me see. here's a variation right off the bat. This says, this doesn't say 50% to 80%. It says 60% to 80%. Now, look all that we would have to change to make that work. All we would have to change is this number right here. Everything else about our application would remain unchanged. Why? Because that code to calculate that minimum is in one place. If we came up with a different rule for the maximum heart rate, we would only need to change that in one place. Each of these functions does one little thing, is isolated, and is modularized. So if we needed to change it at all, we could just make the change in one place, and that would be reflected throughout the site. All right? Now, there's a few issues about this. All right? Number one, we don't have validation in it, so they could type anything in, which isn't good. Now, we know how to do client-side validation, but we talked about last time, or in previous classes, about doing server-side validation. So one of the things that we'll do next time is we'll do server-side validation for this. All right? The other thing that we will do is, that we might do, depending on the time, is we might add, we might combine these two pages into one page. What do I mean by that? We might combine the form part of this with the calculation part. And that will be important to do if we put validation in there, because if we put validation in that says that there's an error, all right, we don't want that displaying on a new page. We want to display it on the same page so that they can just correct the error and move on. So those will be two things that we'll work on next time. That will just make this even better still. Are there any questions about any of this? All right, we'll see you over in lab.